Hello, everybody. How are you all doing? Hope you're having a wonderful day. We're doing some programming today, and we got a couple of things to cover. First of all, enjoy the tree while you can. It's coming down tomorrow. So, last stream with it. Until next year. Next holiday season, I guess I should say. Second thing, I actually have two goals for this year. I won't call them resolutions, but they are goals. The first is I am going to try and get more videos out on my main channel at Kajasi Plays on YouTube. So hopefully you can look forward to that in the near future. I'm actually working on editing up videos from December. And hopefully I'll be able to get those out somewhat quickly. The second thing we're going to try and do is we want to get 1,000 followers on the Kajasi Plays Uncut channel over on YouTube. And don't get me wrong, I'd love to have 1,000 followers over here on glimish.tv/Kajasi, where I'm streaming live. So if any of you can help out with that, please share it with your friends. You know, post my videos on Twitter and Mastodon and any other social media, and get them to come over, follow the channel. That could all help out a lot, and hopefully we can get 1,000 people to subscribe, and a whole lot of hours watched on my videos. Have your friends go watch my old videos. We are up to almost 200 Star Citizen videos. The next Star Citizen video will be 200. I don't know if I want to hold off until Sunday and make it a really big thing, or if I want to try and figure out something to do in this coming week if there's a significant enough patch. More than likely, it's going to be Sunday. So yeah, we got that to look forward to, so that'll be fun. The other thing I need to cover. There was a snafu with my last programming stream, and I lost the VOD. It didn't record. And I don't do local recordings of my VODs for programming, because I really don't think people are going to want to see close-ups of my code on YouTube. So, not going to bother with that. So yeah, let's cover a very brief recap of what would have been programming number 20 for real. Because we tried to do programming part 20, and I just ended up noping out of there because I couldn't, I just couldn't manage it. It was not a day where I could do programming. So, so the last video was supposed to be, part 20 for real, where I actually do manage to get some stuff done. It was also, I had stated that it was going to be the last time that we touch landscapes, trying to generate Unreal Engine landscapes in Unreal Engine. Trying to convert them. I was done. I am no longer going to work on programming those on stream. We will, however, still work with them. It's just trying to convert the data over to a landscape. I'm done with that. I'm not even going to bother. The good news is, because even though that was our last stream, we succeeded. Let me give you just a brief look at the code. And I'll just jump down here. We actually we went through and we kind of reconfigured the whole thing. I mean, here's the code that we've been working on for, like, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 videos now. And keep in mind, almost all of those videos are like 4-hour long chunks. Plus, I'm working on this off stream. I came through here, I looked at everything, I wiped out all the old code and started over from scratch. I started going through chunk. I decided that the best way to do this was to build up a library of, basically we take the original data, we convert it to a height grid, first things first. We'll have a grid, and we'll overlay the landscape data on there, and where the points line up, punch through. So all of the original data is in our point grid. We would then go through and look for any invalid data and then convert that over into a lerp value. So, you know, if it didn't have any of the original data, it would then have a lerp value, and then from there, you know, so that's what all this is lerping and grabbing the data. Then, so at that point, we have a fully functional grid. It has all of our data, including lerped values. So now comes the hard part, trying to string all those values together into a single line, a single array of values. Because the way the data is read is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and that's one chunk. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, and then goes down to these chunks. I need it to read across all the chunks, and I had the hardest time trying to get that to work. I tried for loops, I tried, I tried for loops. I tried all sorts of permutations, and somehow I hit upon, what if I just did a while? So that's what we did. What we ended up doing was we created a while loop. While true, so this will just happen forever until we break. So what we did was we took our grid X, which is where we are on our chunk grid, and every time we hit number 16, we reset and we increased our chunk. So instead of stopping here and going back over here, we instead boop, deck over to the next chunk, and then we'll continue that way. And we keep going until we hit the last chunk, at which point we increase our Y counter. You know, everything gets reset back to the chunk zero, and we continue the next line. And we keep doing that until we hit the very bottom of that first chunk, and then boop, one additional chunk, keep going down. And we keep doing that until we hit the last Y chunk. Actually, no, we need to actually hit the Y chunk beyond the last one. As soon as it detects that, it stops the whole thing. So technically speaking, all of these numbers are actually going to be one over what we can do, but we don't actually do anything with these numbers until we do the check to see if our Y chunk is too high. So we're perfectly fine there. It's perfectly safe. At that point, we come back in, we look to see if it's not the first chunk, and if the grid X is zero. So, you know, we're looking at the first chunk, grid X zero. If it's not that, we increase by 1 point, because we want the left hand side only on the first chunk. Every chunk after that, the left-hand side number is going to be duplicated by the last number of the first chunk. So we're skipping that if we do that. We do the same thing with the Y chunks. When we hit the all but the top numbers of the Y chunks, so we got the top one, and then the next one is actually getting increased, so it's going to skip over that. So this is how we skip past all the duplicate values on the edges of the chunks. We then come through, we find our height point, we do our min-max stuff, we set our destination. So this will be the end point where everything is. And then we increase our height grid and our destination point. So it'll just go through and through and through. We do a couple of other things in here. I've been playing with the Z scale value. And when it's all said and done, we end up in here. We click here. We're on landscape. Let me move over here. We're in here. I've clicked on this landscape. We're going to generate a landscape. I hit create, and there we go. We have a landscape mesh that is perfectly scaled, at least with this one test. I compared this to the procedural mesh that we created. So if I come in here and create a procedural mesh, you can see that the outline for the procedural mesh is almost perfectly matching. I had a hard time trying getting all of the procedural stuff to actually, you know, work out, but I just could not get them to match and overlap in any viable way. It's just it was not working because everything would have a different scale because I was trying to dynamically scale this so it would use the most amount of height values. And as I was trying to go to sleep last night, it hit me. Well, first of all, let me turn on some music. Because I realize I haven't done that yet. We're 10 minutes into this and I haven't gotten music. What kind of hit me was, why am I trying to do this weird dynamic scale thing when I already have the values in here? I just, if I take the, if I convert their height data into centimeters, which is what's used in Unreal Engine, and then I scale that value down so that it will actually fit inside the range for landscapes, all I gotta do is just scale it back up on the Z-axis, which turns out to have worked. What I haven't checked yet, though, because literally I got the scaling fixed about 12 seconds before I had to hit the start button, before I had to hit start talking to all of you, is I haven't checked to see how this works with extreme heights. So let's kind of do that now. I'm gonna now this one next to it is actually a bit of an extreme height. So let's make sure it's set the landscape. Create the landscape. Let's see how it goes. It's not bad. I think we're having interpolation issues. But I gotta say, this is actually the closest we've come. And frankly, a lot of our interpolated data is probably the cause of this. I mean, I am seeing some scenes here. And, the fact that it's, yeah, there's definitely a problem here. So I'm just gonna have to play with this one. Because if it was like every other one, maybe. Of course, I could just come here and see a landscape. Play with some more, but we are done with landscapes for now. I'm going to keep working on fixing this height because it is, that is just a fix. I don't need to, do any more of this on screen. I have to have it in a valid fashion. I just have to figure out how to solve this scene issue. So that's what I'll be doing. I'm not being drowned out by wonderful singing. So what we're going to actually work on tonight is we're going to start working on building up the maps for EDP files. So what I mean by that is there are masks for every single layer. It's good music, but the singing is bothering me at the moment because I can't think of what I'm trying to say. Okay, so we know that this landscape has a whole bunch of values in it. The ADT file has a whole bunch of materials and textures. So if we actually, there should be a listing. Oh, did I hide that data? I might have hid that data. All right, here, let's just open up the ADT source file. What we're going to do is we know exactly what textures are being used in this one ADT file. So that brings up the question, how do we do this masking? Well, in this particular one, there are 7 textures. So that means that for this entire ADT file, not this one, but this one, there are 7 textures. That means that this is going to have 7 masking. And with landscape, masking can actually just be a part of the material. So if we come in here and we go to paint, when we build up the actual material, there will be 7 layers for us to paint on. And we can actually import these as weight maps. We just need to convert them from their source materials, which are effectively just simple masks, into a weight system that we can actually apply to all of the points on this landscape. Now, one of the things we gotta do about this is actually, you know, we're gonna have to build the material, but we're gonna need to build the materials anyways, because we're actually gonna have to build 3 different materials, I suspect. Because there's a lot of different ways that we could do this. I think I actually have an option inside versions. Let me check. All right. Landscapes. Okay, we're going to have to put something here for materials. Global material setups. We're definitely going to need all this. I definitely want to get that going at some point. Yeah, that's fine. Okay, so we're definitely going to have to add the option here for how you want to export. Let me show you. We definitely need to add the option here somewhere where we can actually say how we want landscape materials handled, and we'll probably have that down here. If we just go materials, that's fine. Material instances, so you can specify a parent material, and then here's the parent material path where all of them will be placed. You know, that's stuff that we've already got working. What we need to do now is come down here and actually create one of 3 options. One of 2 options. Actually, no. Can we apply weights to... Yeah. Static meshes might have weights available to them. Of course, when I say weights, what I'm really talking about, at least with the static meshes, is vertex colors. So what we could do with the static mesh version, is actually build up vertex maps from our maps. And we can actually use that to build a material that will function very much like the landscape material. But we are going to have to build 2 separate landscape materials, minimum, possibly, you know, yeah, we're gonna have to build at least 2. I suspect 3. So, one of the things we're gonna work on first is probably figuring that out. But we do want to get out the masks, and so we can actually figure out, how we want to actually apply that data. The first things first, we've got our, values for the textures. So here we've got our textures. So what we're going to want to do is we're going to want to reorder this list. Well, not this list specifically, but we're going to want to create an ordered list from most used to least used, or vice versa. Effectively, it's going to be vice versa. It's going to be, you know, most use on the bottom, least use on top. And we just need to do that across all of the 256 chunks that are in this one landscape. From there, we'll be able to, we then have to figure out, or find out, what the order is, because textures are basically in an order. It grab any 4 for each chunk. Let's actually come down here for this chunk. If we come down here and say that, you know, what you see on screen is one chunk, basically, you can have up to 4 materials assigned to this, and there are weight masks for each one. What we want to do is figure out, okay, what's the one on bottom? That will be our layer 0. And let's just start layering all the other materials using the masks that are specified. That's good, that's fine. The question is, do we want to export these masks as images, which theoretically could be very small, but it means, 256 times 4, that's a lot of images, for 256 materials that has to go on a single landscape. Still a lot. But that's not quite what I want to do. We'll have to go through and figure that all out for all of them, because what we want to do is we want to be able to create a global mask for each texture. So we'll have the bottom layer. Once we get these layers figured out, we're going to actually sort the masks by what their associated texture is. In this case, we have Elwyn Rock-based Test 2. That's index 0 on our list. And then we also have, dirt base and grass base. So let's just, work with these three, I suppose, and the flower base, I guess. But we've got those. Let's say that grass is the most commonly used texture across all of these. That would be place it squarely on the bottom of our layers. And what we need to do is go through all of the chunks and basically create a global mask that is affecting only that grass. So anywhere where this mask is white, there will be grass. Anywhere where there's not grass, it will be black. We then need to do that for every single texture on this. We can then create a global texture mask that can be hopefully applied to everything, and it will actually work. I have tried aspects of this before, but it hasn't quite been as formed as the way I have it in my head right now. So, we're going to work on that today. And this information will actually be highly useful when we want to create a global texture. One texture to rule them all for the whole thing. And that's actually an option we need to put into the terrain options. Because, as we come into versions, if we open this up, there is no option to say how you want the textures exported for your landscape. So that's probably one of the first things we need to do. Now you'll notice that there is a landscape quality option. Why is that? Well, we can scale our textures up. Let me delete this landscape. No, I want to delete the landscape, not that. Okay. So now if I create a landscape, it's actually going to be higher resolution. And you can start to see that there's polygons in here because it's all linearly interpolated. Oh, I wonder if this will work now. Nope. But you can see how it's lerping stuff. Or trying to. I don't know why those two aren't matching up. Granted, I have a fairly good idea why these two aren't matching up. And that happens to be because of all the interpolation happening all the way over here. It can also be, how I'm interpolating. So, one of the things I have actually in my head that I've had in my head for a long time is being able to load another ADT file in order to get the edge interpolation data. Hopefully we can figure that out at some point. Alright, let's continue the music. So we're going to work first with trying to build up our masks. Our mask information. But we also need to, once we actually get them into the landscapes, we need to get that all working. The other thing is, if we're doing procedural meshes, which, quite frankly, is a lot more accurate, because these are the polygons. So if I were to come back over here and create this as a procedural mesh, you can see that these merge perfectly. There's no difference. You can't tell the difference. And this is, one-for-one, World of Warcraft. The difference is, we're trying to build this as better. ignore the water for now. We'll get the water going. With landscapes, we're not touching those anymore until we're doing, you know, weight maps. So I'm actually just going to close that for now. Let's see. Where are we? Oh, yes. I was actually thinking about how I could optimize some of the materials. I'm looking at here. There's a lot of repeated code, but, you know, a lot of that could be fairly easy to figure out. On the other hand, a lot of it is pretty specific. So I think probably the best thing to do is just not worry about materials at the moment. Instead, I want to work through getting this data out, even if we have to save it as a texture file. I'm okay with that. All right, so let's see, where am I? First things first, I put this in here. So, I think it's set in my head. Now let's go to the map chunks. I mean, that's where most of that code's going to be anyways. Ooh, MCAL, that's it. So, we want to go looking for MCAL. Imply, texture definition channels, MCAL. Here we are. So we actually are reading the MCAL chunk. But we're not really doing anything with that data. So, let's double check MCAL. Yeah, it's trying to deprogram it, so that's not too bad. So, probably come back to asset. I'm not certain. So, MCALs, if I remember correctly, they are effectively 64 pixels by 64 pixels, effectively. I keep saying that word. I don't think it means what I think it means. Let me actually open up my screen. Out in a bit. It's been a while since I've had to work with MCALs. Alright. Alpha maps are additional. There are three kinds. Yes. Okay, yes, yes. Okay, yeah, it's effectively a 64 64 by 64. differences the, you know, the source. So we're looking at 64 bits per chunk, or 64 pixels per chunk. That's actually not bad, but when you kind of combine that up with all the others, it gets kind of bad. So let's just start with very simple. We're going to convert them from whatever their format is into image. So this, we're actually going to want to peek a little bit into the code for DLP. Because honestly, it's been a while since I've been working with this. It's an expansion of the MCAL chunk. Actually, yeah, it'd probably be best to do that, wouldn't it? Actually, you know what? I'm going to do this as, not bad. Okay, we'll do this. blatantly stealing from myself. Okay, so now we gotta fill the output. You know, the data output. Now here, looks like we're actually doing it with get image data. We don't have anything like that, so we actually have to do that function ourselves. Actually, we probably did that ourselves too, so. Return the coded data, or decoded data. So. That's alpha, read data. Okay, here's all the conversions. Alright, so honestly, I don't know if we could just toss in our data layers. Probably not. Where's the 32-bit one? That one. There we go. DTX. Yeah, there we go. Just straight RGBA. Alright, so we're gonna go. And assume every data layer is going to be a different color. So. From the chunk header, we'll have the number of layers. Okay. That way it'll actually save the data, and you can come back to later. What we're going to need down here. Alright, so... we're assuming there's always at least one. Okay. It just means that there's no mask on that layer. Now, unfortunately, there's no way for us to test if this works right now. And here we are, tons of errors. Because I'm trying to do a function inside a header, it's probably that, isn't it? Thank you. fine a little bit of it. Maybe it's just, it needs a rebuild. There's some sort of old bad code. That's going to affect the code. Let's see if not having any of those changes makes a difference. It shouldn't, but programming's weird sometimes. I haven't made any changes, so it shouldn't have a problem. Yeah. Okay. Okay, so maybe doing this as a separate, you know, class or something would be best. Yeah, this works. It's not tempt fate. That means it does not work. So, what I'm going to do... Actually, you know what? We can make it into a chunk function. Yeah. Yeah, let's do that. Yeah, functions. Data. Thank you. this is in this file, right? Yeah, this is. There's an image. There's header, which require that. Concerned that it looks like we can't modify our headers without causing it to have a problem. And it appears we still have headers. Redefinition. Yes, I know it's redefined. Include exclusively for BLPs. Now I'm going to be using it for multiple things that, you know, based on textures. Go through each chunk, we're going to get our data. or just MCAL. Let's start with just that. If we can get to at least here without a problem, then we can start actually trying to import the actual files. So, build. Probably is. It might me that, yeah. I don't think Visual Studio understands Unreal Engine, you know, some of the Unreal Engine stuff. My trial for the, really nice plugin that I was using expired. And I haven't been able to get it to work, and I don't have the money to buy it just yet. It's too bad, too. They actually have really nice... had a really nice sale going on. I really want to take advantage of that. Strings effectively. And I'm not certain that I want to look for this if the file exists. Or rather, in this case, not the file exists. So let's skip that for now. And see if just me figuring out the absolute file name is correct. Is a T-car array. It makes sense that I've had to look at it. I don't know why I've forgotten about that. Probably because I haven't been working with that aspect of this for a long time, it feels like. Yeah, it was just that text. Perfect. Alright. So let's see if pressing this button will generate 256 log files telling me the correct absolute file names, which is where these files would be saved. This folder, the Azeroth folder, and it would create a new folder just for this, and it would be, you know, this file name underscore assets, and then it would create all the new MCAL files in there. So that's actually working perfectly. You can now close that. Let's actually do a little connection bit here. I don't need that code at all. Here's the actor. Let's load this up. Construct, create landscape, generate. Where's the MCAL? Import MCALs. So, ADP source. Import MCAL textures. So, simple, one line, but now I can just click on the assets and just be able to import them. Actually, I need to add a little protector first, don't I? Yeah, I do. Is there an existing one? If not, procedural mesh. Sorry, landscape. Yeah, that's what we need. That'll just, you know, quickly connect us. So now that we have this, we need to actually try importing them. So let's see, where are we at? Import texture to path. If no, we're just going to overwrite. New object, automated import. Slightly easy. So, chunk. Say that's in the 16 by 16. Oh, okay. Chunk Y. Chunk X. Assert, make sure that the X and Y on here matches the X and Y on here. No, I'm fairly certain this is going to be perfect. Alright, so that should get us the data that we need. So now, what do we do? We have our BP output data. Texture package. It's a lot of package work here. I don't know. This is kind of almost worthy of its own factory. May not be a bad idea to do its own factory. On the other hand, I could piggyback into some of the other, you know, formats. Just doing this directly. Okay, a lot of package creation. Pointer texture. Let's get the data. Okay, so that's where we actually create the texture. definitely going to use it to affect those things. Now, I could modify the little key on it. Factories are more designed for files. This is data from the memory. Factories in one specific setting, and to copy and paste a lot of that code into what is effectively the formats section really kind of muddies that water. It would almost be worth it to explore saving this as, at least in memory, as a BLP and then trying to import from there. So, what could I do? Well, it looks like I can create a BLP directly from input data. Let's check that out. Actually would not be that hard to make. So what we're going to do is we're going to create a new function in the BLPs, load from raw data. So basically, this is pre-converted code. So in this case, we can just dump it straight from that. Now we'll create a new function. open this up. Add our check. Do all that. Have to create a function for anything else we want to copy over. But you know, probably doing the raw data wouldn't be a bad idea either. Raw.
colors, and touch that, nip size, that, nip levels.
Zero, so that's fine.
Google has alpha. Okay, so let's go to the header. So now we can just load this from raw data and then import it. So, come here. VLP. From raw, and the value is going to be that with a width of 64 and a height of 64. It's not going to find that, is it? I have no idea if this is going to work. So now I can close these, I think. Import textures. is there a way with the automated data to skip destination path, factory. I can specify the factory. Okay, yeah, we can probably do this. All right. So, first of all, let's see. Thank you. we've already done all that. So now we need to build the package. That's right, building a package. So let's go here. So just keep that as target. Actually, no, you know what? That, keep that. We're going to create the new one with the F-color, which is exported as texture 2D. They're going to be the same code, just, you know, using some a little bit different. separate one for chunk. Yeah, I do. Map chunk. All right. So.
They're gonna be, yeah, there's a useless mask.
I honestly don't know. it. So I'll have the texture. I just don't know what to do with it then. Hopefully it will actually be created. That's all I want from this right now. Okay, I probably have to add that package, right? Asset registry. This works, maybe it doesn't. I have no idea. Let's build. Give it a shot. Got a lot of extra code we just dumped in here. Who knows if it's gonna work. So to make it clear, okay, we already had an error. I have no idea what we're doing. Unknown override specifier. What? Do I have to be very specific? I don't like doing these backspace ones. I want to just... So, to be clear on what the landscape material setups we need to do are, we need one for using landscape weight maps. So when we create material, you create a landscape using the Unreal Engine landscapes. That's what we do there. We need one if we use the individual mass on each chunk. Basically, in that instance, we're going to create a master material that handles all of that, and then we'll just have to create instances for each chunk. And we just and that in many ways that's going to be easy. I just don't like that it's going to have a ton of materials on it. And the final version is where we build one massive texture that covers the entire ADT file. It is the least editable out of all of them, but it will probably also give us the easiest one-to-one result. So depends on what people want. The many instances still editable, but a lot of work. Really, the best solution is if we can get the landscapes to match up, so they don't have that problem anymore. And then use the built-in weight system. Now, I'm curious as if I can use a weight-like system in static meshes. I don't think so. I might have to do vertex painting on that instead. And we are still having a problem. Identifier, is that identifier? Even though utilities is included. Oh, no. I didn't include it. No, I need to turn it off. No. Stop. What you're trying to do. I think that works. It's just for some reason it's not actually picking things up. So yeah, those are the three landscape designs that I can think of that we're going to need. The landscape built one will only be available when you have the landscapes. There. So yeah, it's either going to be only generated when you do a landscape one, or only available, you know, I don't know, how would I do that? No, we're only going to generate it if it's available for, well, no. I think what we'll do is we'll set it up as an option and generate it by default when we generate a landscape material. Although we can still set up with the others and have the others work. I'd rather not. It just feels like a lot of wasting. So here's the question. Procedural meshes. Still 184. What? Oh, am I calling the wrong data? Thank you. Because they should not be touching any of that code. They should be doing this too. Oh. Oopsie. Whoopsie noodles! Alright. Very quickly, very simply. See, this is the problem. Trying to, you know, people have done what I've been trying, what I'm trying to do, but they haven't tried to import it into Unreal Engine. At least, not, you know, in the same way I do. Trying to get the source data to import, not translate it and then export it to a different file format, then import it into a new engine. Attempting to write MCAL. That's trying to work with the first MCAL. That's running into errors. On the first one. So, what's happening is that it hits this, it gives me the absolute file name, and then somewhere here it has a crash. not even getting a picture. Well, that's an amazing thing.
Give us some more information.
We'll see if we're getting the right chunk numbers. Because it could be we're not. But I'm pretty certain that I'm doing the math right. At any rate, you know, 0, 0, that should still work. Alright. Issues I'm having up here. Okay, that's the source file. I don't need the source file. Well, actually, I do need the source file there. I don't need the source directory, build number, content directory. So that gets the content directory. But now, If somebody comes along and changes it, I want that to be fixed.
So
grabbing the wrong chunk I guess. This has, you know, things to worry about, like parents and other things. And it's dividing by texture name, or adding the texture name. Meanwhile, we can just go sanitize this path. So that's more than likely going to solve that problem. We're definitely got chunk zeros and both, so... Skip that and I'll get a shot. Yep. Is actually wrong. Convert that to a double. Should be multiplied by 16, but why is that so messed up? It's chunk Y should not be that big. Actually, this is for me to UNT. Yeah, we'll do 16. No, 8. 20. That's only 16. rather than just. Chunk ID divided by 16, Ford, and then multiplied by 16. That should be exactly what we need. But for some reason, when we come down here, chunk Y and chunk X, oh, sense to me. Suddenly these numbers are giving me random values. I'm like, what the hell is going on? Glad we fixed that, you know, other problem. Let's see, base package name, yeah, that's right. Okay, yeah, that's all good. Now we're just trying to figure out what's going on with this. Yeah, sales per chunk, so those are both 16. We've made some really good progress in trying to get this information. It's just now we're kind of stuck on this one issue that shouldn't be an issue. We should easily be able to pull map chunk out. should easily be able to process through map chunks. Yes, I did make the mistake. Now, you know, Y should work correctly. But I still expect this to error out on not being able to get chunks. I don't know why. I knew there was a multiplied by 16. It just had to be there. Alright. I had all the parts, just in the wrong order! But the fact that it didn't crash makes me feel a lot better, but it's still pissing me off that we're getting errors of being unable to find the chunk data. Any other? Yeah, it's being stored there. Oh, you know, I might have to actually move the chunks. Oh, no, no, map chunk is in here. So, why are we having an issue? Do I have to import the mcows? No, 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 we're doing it as a function. Take a little bit more investigation than I want to put into it. I'm gonna give this a one last shot, and then I think we're gonna end it. I'm a bit tired, and I have a couple of things. I would like to see what the final package name is. So I think one way or the other, this is probably going to be our final build of the night. Hopefully we'll be able to see what our final package name is, and we'll be able to, maybe even, get to trying to load a chug. I just want to not get this error. If we can just not get that error, even on one, I'd be happy. If not, I'm going to have to kind of dig into this a bit more. I might consider another method of getting this done. It seems odd that I can't get the chunk. I should be able to. There's no reason I shouldn't be able to. Joining me. There's definitely more to do with MCALs and trying to get these textures out. I hope you all have a good weekend, or a good week. What is this? This is a Monday? Yeah. Hope you all have a good week, and I'll see you on Wednesday. Good night, everybody.